morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to Castle Methodist Church in Colchester. We welcome especially those of us who are listening at home and to those people who watch the program on the internet. Our service comes, as I said, from Castle Methodist Church, and we are very pleased today to welcome back Ed Lansdown to conduct our service. We look forward to hearing what he has to say to us today. Following the service, tea and coffee will be served in the hall, and everyone is welcome. Let us now unite in a few moments of quiet to remember in the holy place that we are in and what we look forward to coming. Thank you.
Good morning. It's nice to see you all again. And this is the day of Pentecost. And we think of a rushing wind and we consider the power of the Holy Spirit and all of the things that we can know and have as a response to our God. Come, now is the time to worship. It's number 24 in Singing the Faith. We'll sing together. Let's pray together. Let's pray. Come just as you are to worship. We are so grateful, Lord, that you don't don't say that we have to achieve anything before we can come to you. We don't have to be of high birth. We don't have to be from a certain place in the world. We don't have to be very clever. We don't have to know anything apart from how to speak with you and how to open ourselves up to your Holy Spirit. We can come to worship you this morning just as we are. Whatever state we're in, whether we're happy or sad, whether we're lonely or we live with a large group of people and sometimes that might feel a bit too crowded, whatever our state, we can come to you. And we bless you for all that you do for us, all that you give to us, all that you mean to us, and all that you can mean to us. We praise you that you promise to be with us if we will open our hearts to you. We praise you that you offer to give us a new life, a life through Jesus and in the power of your Holy Spirit. We praise you that you promise, when we invite you in, that you'll be with us forever and that you will never forsake us. We won't need to be alone. We can know your guidance. We bless you for all the things that you bring to us. And Lord, we thank you for all of those things that we take for granted. For all the wonderful things that we enjoy, and particularly at this time of year when we see how nice the weather is and how bright it is and how we're beginning to get things growing and so on. We thank you for all the things that we take for granted, for we know that not everybody has the bounty that we have. We thank you, Lord, for the people around us. Yes, we don't always get on. Sometimes we annoy each other, but without each other, we would be terribly lonely. And so often it's so nice to be with family or friends and people we know. We bless you for each other, and we ask that you forgive us for the times when we don't feel so happy with one another. Lord, help us to know your presence here this morning, we pray. Forgive us for the times when we will just forget about you or move away from you or want to do our own thing. Help us to know that all you want for us is that we can have the best of you. That we can have life in all its fullness, which means life with you. Lord, forgive us that we don't always remember that. And help us in the future to go ahead with you and not stray. In Christ's precious name we pray. Amen. And let's join with the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You poor young people. Oh, there is three now, that's good. Thank you for coming down here, because this is the bit where I'm supposed to talk to you, but I actually like it. So it's not a chore for me to talk to younger people. I'm just grateful that you're here. It's nice to see you. Now, what I want to ask you this morning, and you adults can think about this as well, really, is things that are the same about us and things that are different. I wonder what you like or what you're good at. If you don't want to talk to me, that's absolutely fine. Some of these young people over here and over there will talk to me, I'm sure. But are you good at something? It's okay, you're not boasting. What sort of things do you like? No? Chocolate? No? You don't know the answer. Okay. How about you lot? You like chocolate? I wonder what, are you good at anything, anybody? No, nobody here is good at anything. Ron, you're good at something. Well, you used to be. You're good at avoiding questions. Yes, it seems to me that everybody's good at avoiding questions. Okay. So, we're very alike in lots of ways, aren't we? I mean, how many eyes have you got? Two. Most people have two eyes. How many arms have you got? Most people have two arms. Right, you're getting the idea here, aren't you? Yeah. So, but are you the same? Are you two people the same? Are you two people the same? You're not the same. You're different in some ways, aren't you? And wonderful ways. Wouldn't it be awful if we were literally all the same? Can you imagine? We're all stormtroopers. Actually, they're probably different underneath, but you know what I mean? We would look the same. And we were all the same. How would you get on? What jealousy there might be, what difficulties there might be. But we're not. So we're the same in some ways and different in other ways. Yeah? Now, as Christians, we are all the same because we worship the one God, don't we? Is that right? Well done, I'm sorry, I'll stop in a minute and then you'll be all right. You'll be pleased when I stop, won't you? We're all worship the one God. And in a sense, we might look the same to people from the outside to some degree, I suppose, but you're all so different. And we all have different ways of being, and we all have different talents. You're all so conservative with a small c, nobody said that they were good at anything. But you're all good at something. Everybody is good at something. And God wants to use those things that we're good at. And he wants to enhance those things that we're good at. And he wants to give us new gifts and new talents, new ways of being. So we need to think about how close we can be, how we can get along together, because let's face it, getting along together is not always easy. Are you a family? Yes? You get along all the time? No? Fight like cat and dog sometimes, yes? I know. And yet other times you get on fine. But as Christians, is it realistic to think that we'll get on all right all the time? No, we're so different, aren't we? And yet at the same time, if we don't get along, if we're not united in our way forward for Christ, how will we show other people the love of Christ? So, we're different, yet we're the same, and we need to give. people around us the truth of Jesus, which is not about disunity, it's not about having trouble getting along with each other, it's about love, and it's about knowing how to work in this world of ours and bringing peace and joy and helping each other and so on, even when times are difficult. And we need a way to do that, and the way is through the power of the Holy Spirit, not in our own strength. Because if we leave it to our own strength, what happens? We revert to type, don't we? We become just who we are, and we argue and so on and so forth. Anyway, you can rejoice in the fact that you're different. Everyone's different, and you've got all sorts of things to offer. But you can also rejoice in the fact that as Christians, we're all the same, and we can all support each other, and we can all know that God loves us, each one equally. And there you are. You're released now. Nice to talk to you. Where are we up to? There's a spirit in the air. Oh, no, we don't. We've got to pray for the young people. There you are. You see, I get things wrong all the time. Let's pray for a moment. Dear Lord, we bless you for our younger people here, and we bless you for the whole congregation. We are a family together. Yes, sometimes we might not get on. Other times we might get on really well. But we pray, Lord, that we will show your love to those around us and learn how to love one another, even in times that are not always easy. We pray now for our young people and for those who will work with them and show them your way, that they will know your love and see your love in action this morning and every day. In Christ's name, amen. Now we'll have there's a spirit in the air, shall we? Oh, we won't have there's a spirit in the air. Never mind, let's forget about it. We'll have the reading instead. And then we'll go straight into the third hymn after that. Okay? Technical hitch here, chaps at home. Don't worry, we'll get there. We'll have our Acts reading, please. Thank you very much.
The Holy Spirit comes at Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews, from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all those who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, and Pamphylia, Egypt and parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in their own tongue." Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, "What does this mean?"
Thank you. Now we'll sing, "Breathe on Me, Breath of God." It's number 370. Let's "Breathe on Me, Breath of God."
Breathe on me.
going to take some intercessions now for a while, I want to consider some things from the news. I'm thinking about this business of not being able to get along with each other. It's so clear and obvious, you don't have to look far to see how, as human race, we don't get along together. How, for all sorts of spurious reasons, we seem to find excuses to upset one another and get cross with one another and fight one another and kill one another. One of these, of course, is the situation in Ukraine at the moment, which continues and doesn't look like stopping anytime soon. Russia has carried out a new massive overnight drone attack on Ukraine's capital, Kyiv, killing at least one person, local officials have said. Mayor Vitaly Klitschko said a man died when a drone wreckage fell near a petrol station, and a woman was injured. Overall, Russia launched a record 54 so-called kamikaze drones on Ukrainian targets, 52 of which were shot down, which was reported by Ukraine's Air Force. Well, this is information that's not been verified, of course. But, they've stepped up attacks, Russia, recently, because they're expecting Ukraine to launch a counter-offensive. And so, more destruction, more death, more injuries. We can't get along. We want to fight over territory. Another story. Seven men have been charged with the attempted murder of Senior Police Service of Northern Ireland Detective John Caldwell. Now, I think probably everybody here is old enough to remember the serious problems that we've had in Northern Ireland several years ago, when I was a lot younger, and of course been going for years and years. Well, this is worrying because we don't want anything to flare up again. Things have been relatively good. Detective Chief Inspector Caldwell was shot in front of his young son at a sports complex in Omagh, County Tyrone, on the 22nd of February. Two of the men are aged 28 and five other men are aged 33, 38, 45, 47 and 72. And they're all expected to appear before the magistrate's court. So this is some people who were, they're supposed to be members of the IRA, which is a proscribed organisation. This violence just goes on, and when you damage each other, what happens is that we all suffer, because the fallout is that we all feel upset, we feel angry, we want to get our own back perhaps, and the whole thing just goes on and never heals. We need to pray for healing of the nations and of the peoples. And we need to pray for ourselves. So let's pray together. Lord, it saddens us to see the conflicts in our world. It saddens us to see how people made in your image are fighting one another and hurting one another and misusing the earth's resources and spending money on armaments when they could be spending money on people who are in such need. Lord, we are so sorry that these things are happening. And we pray for those who are in the midst of conflict today. Particularly again, we pray for the situation in Ukraine, asking that there will be a peace there, that Russia will stop its offensive, and Ukraine will be able to return to being a peaceful nation once again. Lord, we pray that you will convict those who are wrong of their wrongdoing and help them to change, to not just be left in their situation, but have the grace to be able to admit that they need to do things differently. We pray for the leaders of Russia and of Ukraine, We pray for the leaders of other nations, Germany, United States, United Kingdom, and France in particular, but lots of others too, that there will be wisdom and understanding, and that this fighting in Ukraine may stop soon. And we pray about this situation in Northern Ireland, where there's been some resurgence of disturbances in recent times, and this particular murder, which is so sad, or attempted murder, it's so sad that that this should be happening now. We pray, Lord, for the family of this policeman, who will be frightened and worried that there may be another attempt, even though those who were guilty of this have been arrested. We pray, Lord, for anybody who is in fear of violence in our world. We pray, Lord, that you will bring peace in the hearts of people, of your humanity. We pray, Lord, so for ourselves. We ask for the power of your Holy Spirit to bring peace into our hearts. For this peace starts with us, where we feel anger. Help us, Lord. If it's anger that is about something which is clearly wrong, then Lord, help us to be positive in the way we use that anger. If the anger is a negative anger, we pray that you will bring peace to our hearts and our minds. And we pray, Lord, that you will help all of your people to show peace to one another, and positivity, and helpfulness, and kindness, so that others will see how different we are. Help us, we pray. Bring us the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray for this church and all connected with it, asking for your love, asking for your power, asking for your influence, so that people here who gather in your name may do your will by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Christ's name. Amen. And receive the offering now. Lord, we pray that you'll receive these tokens of our love. We pray that you'll bless them and multiply them so that others will know of your love and have a better life in the power of your Holy Spirit and in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, the reading, please.
The reading is taken from 1 Corinthians 12, verse 3b to 12. Therefore, I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, Jesus be cursed, and no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone, it is the same God at work. Now to each one of the manifestations of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one, there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. to another distinguishing between spirits, to another speaking in different kinds of tongues, and to still another the interpretations of tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one just as he determines. Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit, so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, and we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Thanks be to God.
Thanks very much. And we'll continue in song, O Breath of Life, Come Sweeping Through Us. It's number 391. Do you like egg custard? You do like egg custard? No? Somebody over there doesn't? No? Well, when I was at school a day or two ago, a group of friends that I was part of, we used to meet in another person's home after school and at weekends and so on. Sadly, he was living just with his father as his mum and dad had broken up. But that meant he had a lot of freedom, so he had lots of friends around, because I guess the father thought that that'll keep him happy. So we spent a lot of time there. And when I look back on it, we had factions. Even within that little group of friends, there were little cliques, little groups of people who were wanting to be different, if you like, maybe elite or something like that. One thing I remember is that this friend and I made an egg custard. It was a little bit different. Well, it tasted nice, but we made it blue. We thought, well, this is our egg custard. We don't want anybody else to eat it, so we'll make it blue, which did the trick. One slight problem, we couldn't bring ourselves to eat it either. Egg custard is not meant to be blue, it doesn't look very good. We did try it, but we didn't finish it. It was interesting. I have difficulty with elitism. And I also have difficulty with what I call inverted snobbery. What do I mean? Elitism was people get together, they feel that they are somehow better than others around them, that they are in some way elite, special. Of course, the reality is that we're all special. And my wife says to me, "You're special," meaning quite the reverse, but never mind. And what I mean by inverted snobbery is when I see people who are, how can I put it? See, even the language is so difficult. People who feel that they are perhaps normal, ordinary, working class perhaps, will not feel very happy with those who speak in the, what we might call the Queen's English, without getting to know them. Both of these things are just crazy to me. Why would you be like that? And yeah, I was the same, certainly when I was younger. You'd like to feel nice, you like to feel good, you want to feel part of something. And sometimes you can do what they do in football, isn't it? You can press down on somebody else to gain height yourself, as it were. You make somebody feel small to make yourself feel big. Pushing others down in order to feel superior. Well, we had a reading from the letter, Paul's letter, the first letter to the Corinthians. And it was written by St. Paul, or at least that's what we are pretty sure about, I'm sure. And it was written when he was staying in Ephesus. And it's because of the dissension of the Corinthian church that he had himself planted some years previously. And the problem was that they disagreed with one another. There was this difficulty, dissension. And some of them started to follow an eloquent Jew who was very learned called Apollos. And some of them decided that he had the way that they liked and wanted to be alongside him, as it were. Others, followers of Paul, of course, and others, followed something called a Judaizing way, which meant that people wanted things to be pretty much the way the Jews used to be, but sort of add Christianity to it, and so on. There were factions. Even a faction called the followers of Christ. Still a faction. They couldn't agree. They couldn't get along. So, Paul writes to them. It's a protest from Paul saying, this isn't the way it should be. You shouldn't be worrying about whether it's Apollos or whether it's Paul. You should be focusing on Christ. That is what they were trying to do. And that's where we should be, focusing on Christ. Each person has value. Each person is loved by God. Each person is loved by Christ. Each person has something to offer in the kingdom of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 7, we read these words. Each person is given something to do that shows who God is. Everyone gets in on it. Everyone benefits. This is the Message version. All kinds of things are handed out by the Spirit and to all kinds of people. And Paul's explaining that we are all of equal value to God, and Jesus died for all. We are all different, thank goodness, and he loves each one of us in our differences and in our things that are much the same. But petty squabbles and jealousies about position and who did what in the church seem to have troubled the Corinthians. And let's face it, they still trouble the Christian church. Different denominations and so on. We can't seem to want to agree. Paul wrote to try and put this right. Let me read to you. The Holy Spirit is given to each of us in a special way. This is our reading we had earlier. That is, for the good of all. To some people, the Spirit gives the message of wisdom. Great. We certainly need wisdom. To others, the same Spirit gives the message of knowledge. Again, we need these things, each of them. To others, the same Spirit gives faith, a special kind of faith, I guess, so that people will know. To others, the one Spirit gives gifts of healing. To others, he gives the power to do miracles. To others, he gives the ability to prophesy. You see these things, some of these things, well, they're difficult, but yes, we see gifts of healing in different ways. We see somebody might have the power to do miracles, and sometimes we do still hear of things which are obviously miracles, but we also hear of things which are, we say, that's a miracle, although it might not seem supernatural in quite the same way as Jesus did when he was on earth. Some prophecy to talk about what's wise and the right way forward, and maybe just about the future as well as sometimes. To others, the ability to tell spirits apart, to discern what is right and what is wrong. Probably we all need that. To others, he gives the ability to speak in different kinds of languages they'd not known before. And of course, we see in Acts 2 that you had read earlier on, how the people were able to understand what was being said to them. Well, a very practical consequence. These people who were coming from lots of areas, from a very wide area, all heard the message. They were all able to go and spread God's word. Well, that is saying to us very clearly that the gifts that we have from the Holy Spirit are for a purpose, for the good of all. Still to others, he gives the ability to explain what was said in those languages. All of the gifts are produced by one and the same Spirit. He gives them to each person just as he decides. And in Romans 12, we hear these words. We all have gifts. They differ in keeping with the grace that God has given each of us. Do you have the gift of prophecy? Then use it with the faith that you have. Is it your gift to serve? Then serve. Is it teaching? Then teach. Is it telling others how they should live? Then tell them. Is it giving to those who are in need? Then give freely. Is it being a leader? Then work hard at it. Is it showing mercy? Then do it cheerfully. So many different things to slot in to this group of people called the people of God, called Christians. Each person has something to do. Each is of equal value. And if one person fails to do the thing that God wants them to do, then we're all poorer. Might be something in your daily life just that you think might be quite ordinary, but actually would be extraordinary to the people that are around you. It might be something that you think was more important, but of course that's not the way it is. But it might be something that involves something that you find frightening or a bit worrying that you're not sure you could do. Well, try it and see how you get on. We're all able to do something. And we all are capable of receiving God's Holy Spirit. But we have to be willing. A lady writes, "Our younger son celebrated his birthday on crutches, so he couldn't carry the cakes into school without any help. He got birthday cakes, but he couldn't carry them in. I asked our older son to help his brother carry them in. I could, he said, but I'd prefer not to. Spotting a teaching moment, my husband asked my older son, 'What would Jesus do?' And he said, 'Jesus would heal him so he could carry his own cakes.'" You may think that you do not have a gift. You may be worried about being open to the Holy Spirit for a particular type of gift or task. You may think you cannot contribute, you have nothing to offer. You may even wonder if you know God's Holy Spirit. Well, for those of you who might have some concern about this, this passage makes it clear. If you're a Christian, then you do know God's Holy Spirit, and you are indwelt, as we say, by his Holy Spirit. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, we read this, "And without the help of the Holy Spirit, no one can say, 'Jesus is Lord.'" It's not a matter of some Christians having the Holy Spirit and some Christians not having the Holy Spirit. If you're a Christian, you know the Holy Spirit. And beyond that, how we serve is perhaps something that we need to consider, and something which is more about how we are willing to respond to God's promptings. Don't let false modesty or fear stop you from allowing God to build you up as you use your particular gifts or gift for the good of all, and here's the main thing, to God's glory. All includes all of us, obviously. So it's for the good of all, but the emphasis is on others, and the emphasis is on God. If we are attentive to the Holy Spirit, we can know what gift, talent, or natural aptitude God will delight to help us use, each one of us. On each occasion, and the suggestion here is that it's not necessarily the case that you will use a gift, something that you can do for life. It may be that something you are given, an ability, something to help, will only be for a specific period. But it's there, but only if we are willing. God will alert by the power of his Spirit. He'll nudge. He'll let us know. He'll make it clear what he hopes that we might do. But he won't force us. We're not automatons. We can't be programmed. We have free will. And each one of us can turn away and say, "No, I can't do that, Lord." And when we do, each one of us is poorer. So yes, we're all different in all sorts of ways, each unique, but we're all the same as Christians, united in reality, even though it might not feel like it sometimes, as we commit to Christ. We are united, even when we don't like each other. If we're Christians, we're united in that sense. But we need to show it. We need to demonstrate it. Each taking our place with mutual respect mutual support and gratitude to God. And here's what Peter has to say about this topic. This is 1 Peter chapter 4 and verses 10 and 11. God's gifts of grace come in many forms. Each of you has received a gift in order to serve others. You should use it faithfully. If you speak, you should do it like one speaking God's very words. If you serve, you should do it with the strength God provides. And then in all things, God will be praised through Jesus Christ. Give him the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. We'll close with Spirit of God, Unseen as the Wind. It's number 394. I'd like you to have a look around, have a look at each other. Are these people your friends? Are they your enemies? Are they people you can get along with? Are you able to help one another? You hope so. Let's bless each other with the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen. Amen. Amen.